I'm Ian Simm. I'm the founder and chief executive of Impax Asset Management, which is based in London but has offices around the world. So one thing that maybe people don't know about me is that when I was in my early 20s, I put together and completed with my team an expedition to complete the first summer crossing of the Sahara Desert by tandem bicycle. So the Sahara Desert's the largest desert in the world, and in the summer it gets to nearly 50 degrees centigrade. It's 2,000 kilometers from north to south, and about 40% of that doesn't have any kind of road at all. So it's particularly difficult to cycle across. Now, when we did this expedition in the late 1980s, we found out that it had been crossed by bicycle, and it had actually been crossed by tandem bicycle, but in the winter. But we had never been crossed by tandem bicycle in the summer. So that's what we set out to do. It was a 27-day trip, so it's quite a grueling experience, but we got there in the end, and we got a record for doing that. So what I learned from that experience, which was a two-year experience from start to finish, was that if I had an idea for a project and it was ambitious and I put my mind to it, that I could succeed. And we managed to raise about $350,000 to support the logistics for the trip. And we also did some scientific field work when we got to the other end of the Sahara. So that gave us an altruistic purpose for the expedition. But I certainly learned a lot about leadership. I learned a lot about taking an entrepreneurial adventure from start to finish. And I think that sort of set me on my way to starting a company 25 years ago, Impax Asset Management, and following it through for a long period of time to where it is today. So in addition to my work at Impax, I do sit on a number of external boards. So the first of those is the UK government's Net Zero Innovation Board, which brings together the chief scientific advisors from the major departments plus three independent members, and is the main debating area for how the UK government can accelerate innovation around the net zero transition and use public sector funding as efficiently as possible. Secondly, I'm on the board of the Institutional Investor Group on Climate Change, which brings together asset owners and asset managers who are working on policy representation and ideas back to government, but also trying to agree standards amongst themselves. And the third one is the CBI Decarbonisation Board. CBI is a confederation of British industry, so the main sort of industry policy group, if you like. So the members of that group across oil, gas and renewables and power utilities and the grid company are coming together to try and agree policy positions to reflect back to government. What's critical in these policy debates at the moment are issues like how can governments best support the development of the power grid? Because moving from fossil fuel-based energy, which is typically centralized, to a more decentralized power system with, for example, solar panels or small wind farms producing power in remote parts of the system, then it's quite a challenge to develop the grid so that these more decentralized forms of energy, sources of energy, can be integrated into the system. As we move towards much more adoption of electric vehicles, then consumers are going to have the ability to provide storage as a service, if you like, back to the power grid. So it requires quite a lot of investment in controller instrumentation, in data services, providing policy for right price signals. So that's a major theme. Another major theme, particularly in Europe, is the efficiency with which buildings are managing energy. We have quite a cold climate in Europe in the winter, and so buildings are typically not constructed to be draft proof, and there's a retrofit program required to improve energy efficiency, both to sort of stop leakage of heat, but then also to substitute the natural gas which we're using for primary heating supply with a low carbon form of heat, for example using heat pumps, air source heat pumps, and having a sort of electricity based heating system. So one of the fascinating things about this transition to a sustainable economy is that there's no one country which is streets ahead or leading the pack. Many different countries are making different contributions. So for example, in Denmark, you've got the home of the world's leading wind turbine manufacturers. The Chinese typically are the market leaders in solar panel manufacture. In Australia, I think you're in a fabulous position here because of your enormous natural resources, both in terms of the space, land that's available, and the sunshine, which is a fabulous foundation for a massive solar power industry. But also with your almost sort of unparalleled access to rare earth minerals, which are crucial for this clean energy transition, lithium and nickel, for example, then Australia does have the opportunity to be the supplier of the key ingredients, if you like, for the clean energy transition, sort of way up at the start of the value chain. Well, I think in Australia, you now have a political climate which seems to be very supportive of accelerating policy to address climate change. And of course, with the terrible weather-related issues in the last few years, particularly in 2022 and going into 2023, it's very much front and centre of Australian citizens' concerns around where the weather trajectory is going and what's behind it. So I think that political consensus around being an early mover and a sort of fast mover in climate risk mitigation on the one hand, but also perhaps ensuring that you seize the ground for leadership in these new industries is Australia's really well placed. One of the key things that I think needs to happen here, as it does in the UK and many other countries, is a clear trajectory around the development of the power grid. So I think Australia is a very strong case in point that the resources, particularly around solar and wind energy, are a long way from the points of consumption. So finding a way to structure the power sector so that the grid entity can attract capital, low-cost capital from the private sector, billions, if not hundreds of billions of dollars required to extend the grid. That will be an investment that will pay dividends for decades, if not centuries, to come. So finding a smart way to regulate for that transformation is right at the heart of, if you like, the conundrum here in Australia. National markets attract inbound investment and innovation, which can then lead to export markets. So I'd be really encouraging of the Australian government doing as much as it can to create viable clean energy markets here, because I think if that capital can be deployed, maybe initially with import of equipment, then that will lead to innovative domestic companies, which ultimately can then rise to the top of the pack, if you like, in terms of their products and services. They'll get their cost down because they've got scale, and that will rapidly lead to export opportunities. And of course, that then leads to great balance of payments benefits and lots of local jobs.